turn to Jeremiah. And I want you to go with me to Jeremiah chapter 17. Amen. Jeremiah 17. That's the first place we're going to go this morning. And I want you to go to verse 9. Amen. Go to verse 9 in Jeremiah 17. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his way and according to the fruit of his doing. Turn my mic down just a little bit. He said the heart. When he talks about the heart, he's talking about your mind. He's talking about your understanding. He's talking about your ability to have wisdom. He's talking about that part of you that make decisions, the heart. But he's not just talking about the heart that pumps blood. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about the heart of how you make your decisions, of how emotional you are, what makes you feel, what makes you tick, what makes you upset, what makes you happy. This is your heart. He said the heart is deceitful. He said your emotions are deceiving you. He said they are polluting your consciousness.
Come on, now, speak.
They are swelling your head. Mm-hmm. They are making you feel like you're somebody when you're nobody. Mm-hmm. He said the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. He said your heart is sick. It's feeble. It's melancholy. It's incurable. Once an apple begin to spoil, it's going to rot.
Yeah.
When you are green, you're growing. Mm-hmm. But when you're ripe, you're rot. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You can't stop fruit from going bad. But you can stop you from becoming sour. Mm-hmm. Don't become sour because of your heart, because it is wicked desperately, the Lord says. Mm-hmm. And then he says, I, the Lord, search. I'm seeking out. I'm looking for. I'm examining your heart. I'm examining your decisions. I'm examining how you feel. I'm examining your will. I'm examining everything about you. I, the Lord, search the heart and I try the rein.
Amen.
In other words, I try the kidneys. Mm-hmm. It's translated rein, kidney. And when your kidney go bad, your life go bad. When you have kidney problems, you have all kinds of problems. So he ties the heart to the kidneys, and he said that the kidneys and the heart work together. I try the rain. I'm trying everything in your life. So if you find somebody that has bad kidneys, it's because their heart is not functioning properly. Their mind is not functioning properly. Their thinking is not functioning properly. Their soul, their emotions, their will, what they do, the decisions that they're making are not functioning properly. He said, I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the rein to give every man according to his way and according to the fruit of his doing. What kind of fruit do you have?
Come on, now speak.
What kind of fruit are you showing up with? What kind of fruit are you leaving in the earth? What kind of fruit can people or will people know you by? What is your fruit like? Go to the book of Galatians. Go to the book of Galatians. Glory to your name, Father. Because God is trying you. So first of all, Galatians chapter 4, verse 17. This I say therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of your mind. The vanity of your mind. How are you walking? What kind of walk do you have? He said, verse 17, I'm in Ephesians. I'm in Ephesians 4. Then we're going to go to Galatians. Ephesians 4, 17. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you henceforth walk, that you live, not as other Gentiles live, in the vanity of your mind. Your mind is depraved. It's vanity. Look at Ephesians. Look at Ephesians 2 and 11. It says, wherefore, remember that you being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcised by that which is called the circumcisions in the flesh made by hands. He said, even though you are circumcised. Even though the Jews cut away the foreskins from their children, he said, you still have not been grafted into the vine of Christ. You haven't accepted Christ. And we that have not been circumcised, we have the tree of life that we can come to. So now he goes and he says, look at this. Verse 4 and 18. Chapter 4, verse 18. Having the understanding darkened. Your heart. The condition of your heart. The condition of your mind. The condition of your spirit. Is this what you want in your life? Say my heart.
My heart.
Say my heart.
My heart.
Watch this. Having the understanding darkened. Being alienated from God. From the life of God, through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their what?
Heart.
There go their heart. So why are they blind? They're blind because of your heart. Your heart, beloved, has to be right in this season. Your heart has to be right. There are a lot of politicians, their heart isn't right.
That is so true.
Yes.
Trayvon Martin suffered a deadly death.
Yes, he did.
Because people didn't see his heart.
That's right.
And just because you make a law,
come on now,
doesn't mean that it's right if your heart when you made that law wasn't right. So the Bible says that men's heart is desperately wicked. Your heart is wicked. Their heart is wicked. Barack Obama says, that could have been me.
That's what he said.
30 some years ago. Let's look at this. Go to verse number. We're in verse number 19. Who being past feeling, having given themselves over to lasciviousness. Lasciviousness, he means wantoning. Do you understand what I'm saying? You're wantoning. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
Unto lasciviousness, to the work all uncleanness with greed. But ye have not so learned Christ, if so be ye have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus. Now we get to it. That you put off concerning the former conversation. Anytime you change your heart, you're going to change your conversation. If you can't change your conversation, it means that your heart is the same as it was at first. If you coming under a powerful anointing and yet your conversation is the same. If you're under a powerful anointing and your life is the same and your life ain't changing, something is wrong with you. Because it might not be the anointing that you're sitting under. It might be the mind. Your mind, you haven't changed your thought. You haven't changed what you're thinking. You haven't changed what you're doing. And you're still blaming people for what happened 20 years ago. Come on here now. It says, change your old conversation from the old man. What is the old man? Which is corrupt. That old man is corrupt. That old man is spoiled. That old man is ruined. That's the old you. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things, old habits, old ways, old decisions, old ideas have passed away, and now my future is bright because I'm taking on a new conversation. Corrupt according to deceitful, there it is again, deceitful lust. Now watch this, listen to this. It says, and be renewed where? In the spirit of your mind. So the mind carries a spirit. You have the mind or the brain is protected by a skull, bone. The mind is built within the brain. The brain has to be renewed by the Spirit of God. Turn to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God made. And he said to the woman, the serpent began to deal with the woman's mind. Yea, had God said, ye shall not eat of every tree. And the woman said unto the serpent. And what the reason the serpent went to the woman, because she was the weaker side of man. Because man and woman is really one with God. And if they're one with God, the serpent had to find a way into the mind of God. So he found a weaker vessel, a door that he could come into that didn't And because she submitted to the idea or the concept of the words that was spoken, her consciousness fell when the serpent crawled into the skull and came into the brain and hatched eggs in the mind.
Oh, that's good.
And so forever, the mind had failed. So because the serpent had failed, now the mind has fallen. Don't let your mind fall the way the serpent fell. And so now he says, but of the fruit of the tree, which is in the midst of the garden, God said, you shall not eat, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent, verse 4, said unto the woman, you shall not die. It wasn't that the woman completely listened to the serpent, but she entertained the idea that he gave her. Let's go back to Ephesians. It says, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Right? Okay, so then I also said that in 2 Corinthians 5 and 17, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Now, verse 18, it says, all things are of God, who had reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and had given us the ministry of reconciliation. So part of the ministry of reconciliation is that we renew ourselves, or we reconcile ourselves to God and his word. It's not that we have the ministry of reconciliation just to go witness to somebody and bring them to God, but you got to witness to you. You got to minister to you. You got to stay in the word. You got to stay strong. Two weak vessels are not going to stand long. Pigs in the parlor will wallow together. Amen. But eagles will fly and soar even in the storms of life. So watch this now. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 20. But ye have not so learned Christ, if so be that ye have heard of him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus. And then he says, that one of the things he said, put on Christ. Verse 24. And that you what? Put on the new man. You got to put that new man on. You got to put on the garment of the Holy Ghost. You got to put on the garment of the Lord. You got to put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. You got to put on the blood of Jesus that you'll be reconciled. You got to take the word that's quick, sharp, and powerful than a two-edged sword, piercing between the marrow of the bone. And it's a discerner of the thoughts of the mind and the intent of the heart. So you can say one thing and mean another. So you got to balance those things and bring those things into alignment. Go to chapter 5. Chapter 5. Well, go to verse 29 first. It says, verse chapter 4. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good. What's coming out of your mouth? What's coming out of your mouth? What are you speaking? What are you saying? Let no corrupt communication. Look how powerful that is. Oh my God. Look at how powerful. Let nothing that is worthless, let nothing that is rotten, let nothing that is bad, let nothing that is literally morally wrong come out of your mouth. What are you speaking? What's coming out of your mouth? Who are you cursing at? Who are you yelling at? Who are you mad at? Why are you talking about people when you are in a new man and that old man has passed away? You can't live in 2 days. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of thy mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying. When you speak, you should be building up people, edifying people, bringing confirmation. In other words, you become the architect of their life. That it may minister grace. You're going to minister grace to somebody. Favor, thanksgiving, pleasure. And grieve not the Holy Spirit. And you're wondering why you can't hear the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is not going to speak to you when he's grieved. What? Grieve not the Holy Spirit. Don't the word say, be not drunk with wine? That is excess. But be filled with the Spirit. That's Ephesians 5. You cannot be filled with the Spirit of God and then you grieve him with your conversation. Your heart. Let's go to the book of Galatians. Let's go to the book of Galatians. And first of all, glory to your name, Father. Where is it at? There's a part here where he says, oh foolish Galatians.
Chapter 3, verse 1.
Finally, my brother. Yes, go. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I hear you. Yeah. Loud and clear. Oh, foolish. Watch this now. When he used the word foolish, he's saying a person that's unintelligent. Sensual. He's unwise. He said, oh, foolish Galatians. Who had bewitched you? Who spoke to you and put a spell on you? That you should not obey the truth, before whom I, Jesus Christ, had been evidently set forth and crucified. So now he's saying you're bewitched. There is a spell on you. That's why you have to be very careful who you let talk to you. You have to be very careful. Because people will talk to you to deceive you and trick you and manipulate you and bring you under their control and bring you under their spell and cause you to do what they want you to do so they can get the victory over your life and their life will become better and your life will be full of misery.
Say that.
He on it.
Glory to God.
Foolish. Foolish, he said, who had bewitched you that you should not obey the truth? Wow. 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 The heart. Your heart. Watch this. Let me clean this up and let me just clean this up. I want you to go to Jeremiah 18. Verse 12. And they said, there is no hope, but we will walk after our own devices. And we will, everyone, do the imagination of his evil heart. I mean, that's what's going on in the world now. Mm-hmm. You wonder why people are making the decisions that they're making.
Come on, man.
Because their heart is evil.
Come on, America. Mm-hmm.
America kills 1 million babies a year.
Yes, they do.
Through Planned Parenthood and legalized abortion. And then on top of that, America incarcerates more black men, even though there are more Caucasian men that commit crimes.
Yep. Come on now.
It's a heart condition. Why is my color a curse to them, but not to God? Because God is going to raise or is raising up people of color.
Yes, he is.
But the stigma on African Americans is so bad, it's going to take a whole generation to clean it up. If God killed a generation in the Old Testament, and the Old Testament is a foreshadow, he will kill a generation in this testament.
Oh.
So that means that people from the age of 32 to 60 will have to start falling off. If they're in their late 70s, they're going to have to start. The rate of death or mortality is going to have to decrease in order to kill a generation that's still in prejudice. Egypt wanted to keep Israel in bondage. Watch this now. Watch this. Go to Jeremiah 23. Jeremiah chapter 23. Jeremiah chapter 23. I'm coming to a close. This is a good Bible teaching today.
Yes, it is.
Jeremiah 23. Jeremiah 23. And go to verse 9. Oh, my God. My heart within me is broken because of the prophets. All of my bones shake. I am like a drunken man and like a man whose wine had overcome because of the Lord and because of the word of his holiness. For the land is full of adulterers. For because of swearing, the land mourns. America is in a mourning. America is going through, because there is a changing of the guard. There are now new angels that are being released that will take up the cause of the afflicted. And the Lord would say, as these angels are released, there will be warfare. I hear the Lord saying, even if I have to deal with the justice system, judges are going to have to stand accountable for their actions over the past 40 years. For it was the judges and the prosecutors that was looking for promotion and to move high in the political rank to begin to elevate their life status and not the good of the people.
That's right.
Verse 11. For both prophets and priests are profound. Yet in my house have I found their wickedness, saith the Lord. God never made anyone that wasn't walking in holiness to discern and to share his word. Watch this. I told you to read verse 9, right? Go to verse 16. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, hearken not unto the words of the prophets that prophesy unto you. They make you vain. They speak a vision of their own heart and not out of the mouth of the Lord. These are these people that you see that are against African Americans on Fox News Network, CNN, HLN. These commentators are prophesying. Yes. They are not prophesying.
Ah, say that.
They say still unto them that despise me, the Lord had said, yet shall have peace. They say unto everyone that walk after the imagination of their own heart, no evil shall come unto you. Evil is going to come. Destruction is going to come upon people because they are prophesying to a nation.
That's right.
America is no longer just affecting the world. America is, America is not just being seen by America, but it's global. CNN affects 200 million people around the globe. So false prophets.
Come on now.
God had not sent them. They earned a degree. They're dealing with psychology. And they do not have your best interest.
That's right.
For who had stood in the counsel of the Lord and had perceived and heard his word, who had marked his word and heard it. Now I'm going to close right here. Jeremiah, go to verse 26. How long shall this be in the heart of the prophets that prophesy lies? Yea, they are prophets of the deceit of their own heart, which think to cause my people to forget my name by their dreams which they tell, every man to his own neighbor, as their father hath forgotten my name for Baal. So here God begin to say, listen, Baal, Astaroth, all of these fallen idols were sexual idols.
Yes, they were.
The biggest sin in America today is the legalization of homosexuality and marrying men and marrying women to stay in a political seat that you're going to die in.
That's right.
The judgment of God
is
upon the wicked. And if there is wickedness in America, then America will be judged. It's wicked to say that your son can take my son into a bathroom and rape him.
Say that.
It's wicked to say that your daughter, because she's a lesbian, you want to influence my daughter that is a heterosexual. This is wicked.
Yes, it is.
It's wicked.
Yeah, it is.
After all of these years to legalize marijuana, but throw millions of African Americans in jail and give them a longer sentence than they gave Caucasians. It's immoral. And God is going to hold the city accountable. Even the city of Arlington, the city of Grand Prairie, the city of Fort Worth. There were 9 Indian tribes that lived up and down the Trinity River. And with the European settlers came into Texas, along with the Texas Rangers, they slaughtered all of those tribes and they made a treaty. One of the things in the treaty that they made was that if a white man kill an Indian, you will be charged federally. But if an Indian kill a white man, he shall die.
Yes.
Judgment is unequal. And when you read the treaty, and when you read the deception in these treaties, and how they moved the Indians into reservations for their land, for their oil, for their gas, I ask God, is it your will that a nation should perish? And this is his answer. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. God did not want the Indians to be annihilated. Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. What will you give up to get what God wants? God has something great for you. We have to begin to minister from a prophetic pulpit that will change the condition of your heart. I want everyone standing. I need you. You need me. I want you to begin right now as you're standing. Begin to pray to yourself. Begin to pray over your heart. Begin to ask God, am I right? Is there anything in my life that I'm doing wrong? Have I treated people properly? Have I been righteous before you? That was right what you was playing. But go ahead, play that. Yes. Take 2 minutes today and let the Holy Spirit search your heart. I want you, when you leave here today, if you have issues with your mother, issues with your father, issues with your brother, issues with your sister, issues with your husband, issues with your wife, issues with your aunts, your uncles, your nieces, your nephew. Let's start with family. I want you to begin to pray over issues with your family. Nobody's going to lay hands on you. This is going to be a sovereign act of God. Begin to pray that God would deal with your family, that God would deal with your son, that God would deal with your daughters. And say, God, I need your forgiveness. I want my heart to be right. Reconcile me in areas of my life. Let the blood of Jesus go out as it has come down. Father, the blood of Jesus have come down and you have reconciled me to you. I'm not separated from you anymore. Now, Father, let the blood go out to my family. I want you to begin to intercede for your family right now. Begin to pray that the heart condition would be right in your family. That forgiveness would flow in your family. That love will flow. And what's broken will not be broke anymore. Nothing broken. Nothing missing. Nothing broken. nothing missing in this season. God, I want nothing broken and nothing missing in this season. Heal the heart, heal the mind, heal the soul, heal the conditions of life, and bring the people to a place where they know, Lord God, that you are God. I want you to begin to pray for your bosses. People that you work for. People that you don't even know. People that have mistreated you. Pray for them right now. Get your heart right. Let your heart be right. We want our heart right in this situation. We want our heart right in this circumstance. God, touch my heart. That's all you want. You just want God to minister to your heart. You want the Holy Spirit to minister to you. You want the Holy Spirit to penetrate your mind. To deeply, deeply. You want every chain broke. You want every yoke destroyed in your life. My heart. My heart, oh God.
I need you, my Lord.
Let the sovereignty of God operate in your life today. In the name of Jesus. Now, Father, we have prayed. If there's anybody here that you haven't given your life to Christ, you want to do that, lift your hand. If you're here and you're not filled with the Holy Ghost and you want somebody to minister to you that you might be filled with the Holy Ghost, lift your hand and say, Pastor, I'm not filled with the Holy Ghost, but I want to be filled. Somebody will pray for you. I'll pray for you right now, Father, in the name of Jesus. We pray for those that aren't filled with the Holy Spirit. Give them insight into the Holy Ghost. Father, you said that no man knows the day or the time when the Father would put in his own power. But I decree and declare now that the Holy Spirit wants to come into your life, wants to abode in you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Baptism of the Holy Ghost. God can baptize you with the Holy Ghost. He can baptize you. The same way you receive Jesus, you can receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Some people don't have the evidence of speaking in tongues, but they have the Holy Spirit. And some people speak in tongues. Sometimes I wonder if they have the Holy Spirit. Amen. But if you can say that Jesus is Lord, say Jesus is Lord. No man can say that Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Spirit. So Father, tonight we speak the grace, we speak the favor, we speak the blessing upon your people. Cause them to rise, cause them to come to another level. In time, in this dispensation, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have dealt with the heart. God, you said in this season that our heart got to be right. You're looking for a people. You said you'd give us a new heart, not a heart of stone, but a heart of flesh. I thank you now, Father, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I pray for those that need special prayer. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, God. We lift you up now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Would you take your seats as we prepare to take our offering? can take our times to gather this evening.